So good afternoon, everyone. So welcome to the last of the three lecture series of Professor Michelle Wasmith. So we're hoping to get some new connections extra today. So
thank you. So this is the end of the story. First of all, I wish to thank you and to congratulate you for coming here up to the end for the third lecture. So I am pleased that the room is not empty, especially for those who came for the previous lectures. And so I mentioned that I will try to make the three lectures as independent as possible. Unfortunately, there is a small discrepancy for that, which is that yesterday I forgot something I wanted to say, and so I would like to come back to something which I said yesterday, but after that it will be more or less independent. In fact, at the end of my first lecture and at the beginning of the second lecture, I gave a sketch of proof of transcendence. There were several steps. This proof was given in a rather broad setting. We had a function f. We had some points alpha I. It was assumed that the alpha are algebraic, and f of alpha is also algebraic. We were taking monomials in z and f of z. And the first step was a construction, the existence of an auxiliary function, which is a linear combination of such numbers. But we took the derivatives. It was one variable. And we took the derivatives at the points alpha for which z and f of z are algebraic. So we have t, I, lambda 0, lambda 1. And the first step was a linear combination with lambda 0, lambda 1 of these values, which is 0. So it's the existence of an auxiliary function. And then the second step was the zero estimate, where we prove that one of these derivatives is not 0. So if you look at this proof, it means that we are dealing with a very big matrix, where on the one hand you have lambda 0, lambda 1. So say that lambda 0 is between 0 and L0. And lambda 1 is between 0 and L1. And on the other hand, you have the variable t, where t is between 0 and capital T, and I is between 1 and n. So the first step was to prove that there is a linear combination which vanishes on lambda 0, lambda 1. And the second step was to prove that for some t and n, we have a value of the auxiliary function which is not 0. It was an idea due to Michel Laurent, to avoid the construction of an auxiliary function. So what he did, instead of starting with the first step and then the second step, he starts with the second step. The second step says that one of the values is non-zero, which means that for some values of t and n, the rank of this matrix will be L0, L1. And so he starts with the second step, and then he said there is, so for suitable, so this is the zero estimate. For suitable t and n large enough, the rank of this matrix is L0, L1, is maximal. And then what he does is to look at the determinant of L0 times L1 matrix. It's a non-zero determinant. Of a matrix of size L0 and 1. Which is non-zero. And so it's a number, it's an algebraic number. The third step is it was to use the Schwarz lemma. The third step is an upper bound for delta using the Schwarz lemma. It's a rather clever one. And the next step is a lower bound for delta using Liouville's inequality. So it avoids the construction of an auxiliary function. We do not have to introduce an auxiliary polynomial. We just look at the so-called interpolation determinant. So this is the name, interpolation determinant. To speak frankly, it does not yield the spectacular new results on transcendance. It's just a proof which is slightly smoother, and it gives some improvement for explicit estimates. So it's useful, but it's not a revolution. The next step was done by Jean-Benoît Bost. Which introduced the slopes inequality using Arakelov theory. I will not say too much about that. I will just say the basic idea. It is that when you have a determinant and a matrix, it means that you have a linear map. But not only a linear map, you have also a basis. And with the basis, you have a determinant. The idea of Jean-Benoît Bost is to say we have some vector spaces, but we do not take a basis. And it's possible to replace the non-zero determinant and the upper bound which arises from Schwarz lemma by some inequalities which are called slope inequalities. The interest of that is that when we work with transcendance results on abelian varieties, it makes the result more intrinsic. We do not have to make choices, and it gives something which is better. Okay, this is what I forgot to say yesterday. Now, I would like to explain the transcendance results in several variables. It's here, yeah. So, to speak frankly, yesterday I explained how we extend the Schwarz lemma in several variables, introducing an invariant which was the omega of S. This is a nice result, but it turns out that we do not use it in the proofs of transcendence. So it's a result which is of independent interest. We have some other ways of proving results in several variables. I will start with one of my favorite topics, which is the so-called six exponential theorem. And the four exponential conjecture. This story started with a work of Ramanujan on highly composite numbers. Ramanujan has a well-known paper on this topic. And this paper of Ramanujan was developed by Alaoglu and Erdős. And when they studied this paper, they found that Ramanujan used a result which is of the following form. If you have a real number t such that 2 to the t is an integer and 3 to the t is an integer, then this implies that t is a non-negative integer. So this is what was used by Ramanujan implicitly. He does not state it, but he used it. It was not 2 and 3, it was P1 and P2, two prime numbers. And so Alaoglu and Erdős thought that it's necessary to give a proof of that. And so they asked Ziegel. And Ziegel answered, I am not able to prove that. And indeed, this is an open problem. So it's a conjecture. It's a nice conjecture because it's easy to state, and it's an irritating conjecture because if you look at the method of transcendental number theory, they almost give the result, and I have spent hours and days to try to prove it without success. In fact, I succeeded several times, but each time my proof was wrong. And so Ziegel said, okay, I am not able to prove that, but I am able to prove that if you assume 5 to the t is also an integer, then t is an integer. And so this is the sixth exponential theorem. Maybe you find only 3 numbers here, 2 to the t, 3 to the t, 5 to the t, but you have 3 other numbers which are 2, 3, 5. And the so-called sixth exponential theorem, which is Ziegel's result, you take 2 numbers x1, x2, which are complex numbers, and linearly independent. Of a Q, and you take 3 numbers, y1, y2, y3, which are also linearly independent of a Q, and you look at the numbers exponential xi, yj, you have 6 exponential, and the result is that not all of them are algebraic. So not all are algebraic. Of course, you deduce this easily by taking y1, y2, y3, which are log 2, log 3, log 5, and x1 is 1 and x2 is t. And the 4 exponential conjecture is the same, but you take only y1, y2, and then you have 4 exponential. So this is the theorem. This theorem was apparently known to Ziegel, even if he did not publish it. I met Zellberg several years ago, and he told me that when we spoke on that, he said, oh, of course, I knew the proof of this result, but I wanted to prove the 4 exponential conjecture, and he did not succeed. And so this is the problem. I start with this question for the following reason. We are looking at the exponential of xi, yj, which means that if I define alpha ij equal exponential xi, yj, the xi, yj, we can write that it is the logarithm of alpha ij. There are several definitions of the logarithm. This is, when I write log alpha ij, I just mean one number so that the exponential is alpha ij. You have several determinations of the logarithm. Now we can take a matrix uij, say with 1 less than I less than D, less than J less than L. So this is a D by L matrix. And an easy result is that if uij are complex numbers, this matrix has rank less than or equal to 1 if and only if there exist x1 xd y1 yd yl so that uij is equal to xi yj. This is an elementary result. Now we can wish to consider the condition that the matrix has rank less than or equal to n. So let me give an integer n greater than or equal to 1. And the result is that the matrix M has rank less than or equal to n if and only if there exist x1, xd, y1, yl But now they are in C to the N. And Uij is Xiyj. But now this is the scalar product, standard scalar product in C to the N, the product by component. So if you have, say, A1An and if you multiply by B1Bn, this is the sum of AiBi. So if you we replace the xi in C and yj in C by elements in C to the N, we are dealing with the functions of several variables. And this function will be, we take x1, xn, and xd in C to the N, and we will look at the function exponential xiz. Z will be a variable in C to the N, and exponential xiz is just a function of n variable where it is the scalar product. So we have d functions. Of n variables. And so the transcendental proof will deal with functions of n variables, and we'll look at the values of this function on the group zy1 plus zyn, yl, which is a subgroup of C to the n. And we will use the method, the sketch of proof which I gave. One difference is that we do not take derivatives in this case, because we do not assume that the xi are algebraic. They are complex numbers, as I explained before. And using this kind of idea, we can study the rank of matrices with entries which are algebraic numbers. The xi, so the values that we find are xiyj and some monomials in these numbers. And we assume that these are algebraic numbers. And so we are dealing with matrices, the entries of which are algebraic numbers. And so the main question is, what is the rank of a matrix with entries logarithm of algebraic numbers? And there is a conjecture for that, which I will call the conjecture on the rank of matrices. With entries logarithm of algebraic numbers. In the special case which I just erased of n equal 1, we just had the assumption that x1, x2 are linearly independent, and y1, y3 also. Here, it's not sufficient to assume that the x and the y are linearly independent. It is necessary, but it's not sufficient. We need something else. And the conjecture was formulated by Damien Roy, and I will write the conjecture in a very simple way, which is that the rank of such a matrix is equal to the conjectural rank of M. And now I just have to define what is this. What is the conjectural rank of such a matrix? You have the log alpha ij. You take a basis of the log alpha ij as a vector space over Q. So the log alpha ij span a vector space over Q, subspace of C, which has a certain dimension, and to take a basis of the Q vector space in C. So let me say that it is L1 LS. The L are logarithm of algebraic numbers. There are some of these numbers here. And so you write the log alpha ij as the sum for sigma equal 1 up to S of some rational numbers, say A ij sigma, and you have this L sigma. And of course, the Aij sigma are rational numbers. And now you consider a matrix, which is a matrix with entries which are given by variables. So you take the matrix, which is the sum for sigma equal 1 up to S of Aij sigma x sigma. So I replace the L sigma by variables. So it's a D by L matrix. The coefficients are linear combinations of the X sigma. There are linear forms in X1, XS. But I consider this matrix as a matrix with coefficients which are in the field Q of X1, XS. This is just a field. We have a matrix. This matrix has a rank. And this is the conjectural rank of M. So the rank is, by definition, the conjectural rank of M. We chose the basis, and it's easy to see that this number does not depend on the basis. And so this is the conjecture on the rank of matrices. And what does it mean? It means that when we have linearly independent logarithm of algebraic numbers, they should be algebraically independent. So this is another conjecture, which is a special case of Chanuel's conjecture. It is a conjecture on algebraic independence of logarithms, and it is the conjecture we say that if L1, LS are Q linearly independent logarithm of algebraic numbers, they are algebraically independent. So the assumption is that they do not satisfy any linear relation, and the conclusion is that they do not satisfy any polynomial relation. This is a classical conjecture. Maybe I will say later what is Chanuel's conjecture, but I just need this special case of algebraic independence of logarithms. We can say that we know nothing about this conjecture, meaning that we do not know that there exists algebraically independent elements in among the logarithms. There exist two algebraically independent elements in this set, which means a logarithm of algebraic numbers. So it may be that all the logarithm of algebraic numbers, log 2, log 3, log, any of these numbers is a polynomial in pi, for example, or in I pi. This is something which we do not know. So this conjecture is essentially hopeless, but we know something, conjecture which is here, using exponential in several variables, and the theorem is that the rank of m is greater than or equal to the half of the conjectural rank. Of m. And
sorry, I missed it somewhere. Can you repeat that?
Excuse me?
Could you please repeat the Chanuel's conjecture?
Okay, the conjecture of Chanuel is more general than that. So the corollary is the conjecture of algebraic independence of logarithm. The assumption is that you have logarithm of algebraic numbers which are linearly independent. They do not satisfy any linear relation. So you can take a log 2, log 3, log p for the prime numbers. They are linearly independent. And the conclusion is that they should be algebraically independent, which means that they should not satisfy any algebraic relation. Log 2 square minus log alpha square is not zero. And so we do not know anything here. We know something there. Moreover, from the definition of the conjectural rank, it is easy to deduce this conjecture from Chanuel's conjecture. But what is really remarkable is that there is a result of Damien Roy, which is that both conjectures are equivalent. The conjecture on the rank of matrices and the conjecture of algebraic independence of logarithms are equivalent.
So this theorem is also Damien theorem?
Sorry?
This one is also Damien
theorem? No, I proved that, and he proved the result which is here, which is that the rank equal the conjectural rank is equivalent to the algebraic independence of logarithms. So both are equivalent. We know half of one, and we know nothing about the other. It means that when you have a problem, an open problem, it's important to change your point of view. If you do not succeed with one point of view, you try to change the problem, if possible, with another one which is equivalent, and try to get something on the other problem. The proof of this is very easy. From the definition which you have here. You have your L sigma, which are linearly independent logarithm of algebraic numbers. You replace them by variables. They should not change the rank if the L sigma are algebraically independent, because you have coefficients in Q. So this is clear. Now for the opposite direction, you have to say that if you know what is the rank of a matrix with entries logarithm of algebraic numbers, then you know the algebraic relation between these numbers. And this relies on a lemma by Damien Roy, which is any polynomial in several variables, say in k of x1, xn, is the determinant of a matrix, a square matrix, with entries which are in k plus kx1 plus kxn. So Damien proved that just for this purpose. And it's only recently that I learned that this kind of lemma is well known. And this is the basic result of the arithmetic complexity of a polynomial. You start with a polynomial. It is the determinant of some matrix, and you want to find the matrix of the least size. So the smaller size of such a matrix is the arithmetic complexity of P. And there are some open problems related to that. I just learned one of them by Vijay Patankar just before coming here, which is that if you take the permanent, which is the determinant of like the determinant of a matrix Xij, but you remove the sign plus or minus. So you have a polynomial in Xij, which is the sum for the permutation, and then you have the Xi sigma of I, but you do not put the epsilon of sigma. So you have a polynomial in n square variable with coefficients which are just one. So it is a determinant of a matrix. What is the smaller size of such a matrix? We expect that it is super exponential, and we know only that it is at least the square of n. So there are a lot of open problems in this domain. So when do we have to deal with matrices with entries which are logarithm of algebraic numbers? The most well-known case is the topic which was suggested to me by my PhD advisor Jean Fresnel when I started some research. It is Leopold's conjecture. On the periodic rank of the units of an algebraic number field. So when you have an algebraic number field, so it's a finite extension of Q, you have the ring of integers, which are the elements which are integers over Z. And then in this ring, you have some units. And the structure of the group of units is known by Dirichlet's units theorem. And when you have such a number field, you have some real embeddings. Say R1, you have R2, to R2, the number of complex embeddings, pairwise conjugate. And the degree is R1 plus 2R2. And the rank of unit is R equal R1 plus R2 minus 1. All this is with the Archimedean absolute values, real and complex. And something similar can be done with a periodic absolute value. And there is a way to define what is the periodic rank of the units. It's a number Rp. And the question is it true that Rp is equal to R? And this is Leopold's conjecture. This number Rp is the rank of a matrix, the entries of which are periodic logarithm of algebraic numbers. And all what I said can be done in the periodic case. And we have also the result that the rank Rp is at least half of the conjectural rank. And the conjectural rank is R. So the result which is known is RP greater than or equal to 1/2 of R. And this is the best result in general. So the conjecture is still open. When Fresnel suggested me to work on this topic, he first told me, you see, to prove RP equal R, you just have to prove that some determinant is not zero. That should not be too much difficult. And that was in 69, and it is still open, and it's still considered as a difficult topic. Yes. I would like to explain another situation where we have such maybe not a determinant, but at least some exponential in several variables. And this is the Hecker characters and the conjecture of Weyl, André Weyl, on Grusson characters, they are called. Or Hecker character of a number field. So when in this theory, we have a number field and the Idel class group of the number field, and then we have an homomorphism, a Hecker character, as it is said. But this Hecker character gives rise to a map which starts from the tensor product of Q with R. But you can forget this if you do not know. This is just a map which goes from the real numbers to the power R2. And the R1, sorry, and then the complex numbers to the power R2. So you just take a R1 copy of R, the real numbers, and R2 copies of the multiplicative group of C. These are R1 and R2, which are here. We have
Can I ask
yes.
A question about
earlier? Yes.
You had a similar theorem for related to Shanuel's conjecture in the half rank.
No. It's the same, yes. In the PID case and in the complex case, it is the same, yes. In the PID case, we have also the result for any matrix. We can say that the rank of a matrix is at least half of the conjectural rank. So for the rank of matrices, we can do something, not half of what we expect. For Shanuel's conjecture, we have a similar conjecture for the algebraic independence of logarithms. And in the same way, we know nothing. We do not know the transcendent degrees at least 2. So we have a map, say psi, which goes to C star. So the elements which are here are Z nu, where nu goes from 1 to R1 plus R2. So these are just either real or complex non-zero numbers. And we map them, and these are the Grusson characters, into a product which is like this, nu equal 1 up to R1 plus R2. Then we have Z nu over modulus of Z nu power M nu, and Z nu to the power T nu. So you can forget about this and say just you have a map which is defined by this. The M nu are integers, and the T nu are complex numbers. And so Weyl introduced the definition of character of type A and type A0. And they are done in such a way that the type A will imply that if you look at psi of K star, so K can be embedded in R to the R1 and C to the R2 by using the real embeddings. So you view K star as a subgroup of this by taking the sigma of alpha. A type A will mean that the image of K star is contained in the algebraic numbers. I will define what is A. But it's done in such a way that the type A0 implies that psi of K star is contained in a number field. So how can you define the type A and A0 like this? Type A is easy. You define type A by asking that the T nu are rational numbers. If you take rational numbers, if you take the Z nu, which are all algebraic, then the image is given by algebraic numbers. Now, for the type A0, it's a little bit more subtle because you want that the values are in a fixed number field. So the Z nu will be in a number field, but the Z nu to the T nu, you need to assume that the T nu are in Z, but also you have the absolute value of Z nu, which makes trouble, and so you have to assume that T nu minus 2 minus mu is an even integer. Like this, you have the modulus square, and the modulus square is an algebraic number in a fixed number field. So this is the definition.
Sorry, I missed something. So this psi of k star means so this is the image of k star in the tensor product.
Yes. I should have given the definition before, but I gave it after just to explain what we want. So the definition this one, and then Veil remarked that in the case of type I0, the image of psi is contained in the field of algebraic numbers. In the case of type A0, it is contained in a number field. And the question of Veil was whether the converse is true. And this this comes from using exponential function in several variables. So the converse is true. If all the images are algebraic numbers, then the T nu are rational. And if they are in a number field, then T nu is in Z, and T nu minus M nu is an even integer. I should say that all this, with the character of type A0, has a p-adic counterpart. And this was a question raised by Serre, and the solution was given by Enyar using this result, which are here. Okay, I would like now to go to topology, because I promised to speak of topology, but this is closely related with what I did. So it's really the continuation of the study of exponential function in several variables. There is a close connection between topology and transcendence problems or irrationality problems due to the following. There is a well-known result in the Diophantine approximation that if you have a number x which is a real number, and if you take z plus zx, which is a set of elements a plus bx, a and b are in z, then this is dense in R if and only if x is an irrational number. This is one of the basic results in the Diophantine approximation. And we are interested in the same result in the higher dimension. I will just give the statement for R square. So you look at Z square plus ZXY. So this is the set of elements of the form A1 plus A0X, A2 plus A0Y in R square, where A0, A1, A2 are in Z. And you ask, when is this dense in R square? And the answer is the following. It is dense in R square if and only if 1, x, y are linearly independent of a Q. And we have similar results for higher dimensions. And so we will be interested in this situation, but again, instead of 1x, instead of 1 and x1, I will take logarithm of algebraic numbers. And using the exponential function, I will transfer that into a problem of density when we take a multiplicative group which is generated by elements where the coefficients, the entries, the components are algebraic numbers. And I have prepared a specific example to show what is the problem. And so it's just one example. We could give many others like this. Let me take the field Q of square root of 2. So we have R1 equal 2 and R2 equal 0. There are two embeddings in R, which is A plus B square root of 2. We map it to A plus B square root of 2, A minus B square root of 2. So I will take in this field several elements. The first one is 1 minus 2 square root of 2. The second one, alpha 2, minus 1 plus 3 square root of 2. And alpha 3 is 5 minus 2 square root of 2. And I am looking at the image of the subgroup which is generated by alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. So I look at the elements of the form alpha 1, A1, alpha 2, A2, alpha 3, A3. And there are non-zero numbers with the exponent 3. And I ask whether the set of these elements with the AI which are in Z is dense in R cross cube. To look at this, I have to, if I take the logarithm of this, it means that, I look at these elements, but I look at this and I will take the conjugate. Okay, so maybe I should first say that these elements are in the Q of square root of 2 cross cube. Well, for the moment, these are just non-zero elements. So they are here. When I take the image by this map, let me say that sigma is this map. If I look at sigma of alpha 1, A1, alpha 2, A2, alpha 3, A3, then this is in R plus R cross square. Okay, this is what I want to do. So I have a subgroup of R cross square. And if I take the logarithm of this problem, I have to consider the group, subgroup of R, which is spanned by log alpha 1, log alpha prime 1, plus log alpha 2, log alpha prime 2, plus log alpha 3, log alpha prime 3, where the primes denote this number. So if this is alpha, this will be alpha prime. So this is a subgroup of R square. And this subgroup is dense in R square if and only if the multiplicative group is dense in R cross star. And so we have a criterion to know whether it is dense. We have to change the basis. We write this element into the basis which is there. And we have to know whether 1, x1 are linearly independent. I will not write the details, but I think it is clear that this element, log alpha 3, log alpha prime 3, can be written in the basis which is here with the coefficients xy, which are polynomials in log alpha 1, log alpha 2, and the prime. And so to know whether these numbers are linearly independent is a problem of algebraic independence of logarithms. We do not know anything about that, and it turns out that the fact that this is dense, so let me say that this is a group. So this is a group when I take all the in Z, and the fact that G is dense in R cross square is a consequence of the four exponential conjecture. But this is open, we do not know. But we know the six exponential theorem, and so we can do something weaker, and we add another number. So I take alpha 4, which is minus 1 plus 4 square root of 2. And now, if you take the subgroup which is generated by alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 4, we can prove that it is dense. The image is dense. So the subgroup generated by alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and alpha 4 has an image which is dense. So it's not exactly what we would like, because we would like a subgroup of rank 3. We would like 3 elements. But however, it's possible to get something in this direction by taking another number, which is alpha 5. And alpha 5 is 7 minus 2 square root of 2. Of course, there are many other values which are admissible, but I just checked that this is true for this one. And one result which we can prove is that there exists a subgroup of rank 3 contained in the subgroup generated by alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 5, alpha 4, alpha 5, which has a dense image. This construction is a bit tricky, and it was done again by Damien Roy. In fact, this is a special case of a very special, very general problem, which is that when we have the canonical embedding of K into R to the R1 cross C to the R2, we map an element in K into its conjugate. We have the map for the multiplicative group. And the question was whether there is a finitely generated subgroup of K star which has a dense image. And this was proved by Damien Roy, that there exists a finitely generated subgroup of K star of rank R1 plus 2R2 plus 1, which has a dense image. So I'm afraid I have 5 minutes left. I wanted to speak on dynamical systems and on algebraic combinatorics. Yes, it's possible? Ah, okay, so, very good. In this case, I can say something about dynamical systems, and then we will see. After 10 minutes, I will ask you 10 more. Okay, so, about dynamical systems. There are several connections with transcendental number theory. The most classical one is with the rotation number, which is that you have a map, you have a set V, which is an open set in C. You have a map F, which goes from V to V, and which has a fixed point, Z0, F of Z0 equals Z0. And you iterate the map. And you look at the behavior of this system, and the most important invariant is the derivative of F at the point Z0. To study this map, we look whether it is conjugate to a map which will go from the unit disk to itself. So it is the unit disk is z less than 1. And you want to know whether this map is conjugate to a map from the unit disk d to itself with a map h here, which will be analytic. So f will be analytic. And you ask whether this is conjugate to rotation, which is z gives lambda z, with lambda which is given by this number. So in this case, we say that f is linearizable. And it is a classical result that if lambda is different from zero and different from one, then there exists such a map H, and H is unique. So the case which is interesting is lambda equal 1 of modulus. So we write lambda equal exponential 2i pi theta, and theta is the rotation number. The conjecture 1 century ago was that even if the modulus of lambda is 1, every map like this, F, is linearizable. And it was disproved a few years later. And what was proved, the result which was proved in 1927 by Kremer, is that in the generic case, there is no H. The map is not linearizable. What means the generic case? The generic case means that it is for a set of theta, the rotation numbers, which is a G delta set, as I mentioned in the very first lecture. The complement according to Baire category is a meager set. So in the generic case, it is known that there is no H, not linearizable. And it was proved just a few years later by Ziegel in 1942. That if theta is not a Liouville number, then, so the Liouville numbers is a generic case, and not a Liouville number, then F is linearizable. And there were some further studies on that, in particular by Bruno, who introduced a Diophantine condition which is different from Liouville, and then in 1988 by Yokos, And so this was the start of the begin the start of the theory of Kolmogorov, Moser, and Arnold, CAM theory.
But this proof is, I mean, like constructive proof or just existential proof?
Oh, the proof by Siegel, the existence of age. The existence of age is. So he uses, if I remember, a compacity argument. So the proof is not constructive. There exists. But I would like to consider a special case, which is the case of the contracted rotation. The contracted rotation are given by F lambda delta of x is lambda x plus delta. So we take we take the fractional part of lambda x plus delta. So this is the fractional part. And we take x, which is between 0 and 1. So we are not exactly in this situation because we do not have a complex dynamical system. It's a real dynamical system. So we have the interval 0, 1. And we have a map which goes from 0, 1 to 0, 1 because we take the fractional part. The fractional part, when you have a real number t, you write it as the integral part plus the fractional part, which is between 0 and 1. So there is a rotation number theta delta lambda, which is defined in a similar way. And the connection with transcendental numbers is very peculiar because usually transcendental theory is done in such a way that we prove that some numbers are transcendental or at least are irrational. But a result of Laurent and Noguera is that if lambda and delta are between 0 and 1, not 0, not 1, and if they are algebraic, then this number, theta delta lambda, is rational. So it's a bit surprising that the result of transcendence has the conclusion that some number is rational. But the reason is the following. Assume that theta is irrational, then they have an explicit formula. It's theta and lambda and delta. They give delta in terms of theta and lambda. And then they use a result on the so-called Hecke-Mahler series. Which are the series of the form, the sum for k equal 1 and to infinity of the integral part of k rho times lambda to the k. A result of Mahler about this series is that if rho is an irrational number, if lambda is an algebraic number, then this series is transcendental. So this is really a transcendence result. But the point is that we do not need any property on rho, no arithmetic property. We just need that rho is irrational. And so using this result, you can say that if this series is algebraic and if lambda is algebraic, then rho is rational. So this is how they use it. This is why there is a connection between a transcendence result and some dynamical systems. Did I use only 5 minutes? Okay, I promise to say something about algebraic combinatorics. And I will just mention two things. One is a paper by Francis Brown. It's a recent paper, the title of which is irrationality proofs of zeta values, moduli spaces, and dinner parties. So in the title, you have zeta values, moduli spaces, and dinner parties. So irrationality of zeta values, I did not explain the theory, but it is a result like the irrationality of zeta of 3. And he's interested in the theory which was developed starting with Apéry and the proof of zeta of 3. Moduli spaces. Francis Brown introduced some theory of it's a motivic theory of the zeta values for multiple zeta values. It uses motifs, so it's a very advanced method that he's using, and he proved a number of results which are related, we can say, with the motivic Galois theory and the Galois group of Q bar of Q. And so this is a very deep mathematics, and it's interesting that it's related with zeta values. Dinner parties is a combinatoric problem when you have some people around the table and you want to change their place in such a way that if you compare the first time and the second, no two people are next to the other. And he has a combinatorial problem involving dinner parties, for which he doesn't have the full solution, but he has a partial solution which is just sufficient for his purpose. The second topic which is related with that, which I would have liked to discuss a little bit more, is the work of Adam Seski and Bugeaud. Using Schmidt's subspace theorem, because I told you I would mention Schmidt's subspace theorem today, so I just mentioned it like here, which says that if you have an algebraic number and if you look at the decimal expansion or the binary expansion or any expansion, the expansion of an algebraic irrational number in any basis, so say greater than or equal to 2, of an irrational algebraic number it cannot be given by a finite automata. Cannot be given by a finite automaton. I told you in the first course 3 days ago that we know almost nothing about the expansion of an algebraic irrational algebraic number. For example, for the decimal of square root of 2, we cannot say that some digit, 2, for example, occurs infinitely often. We do not have anything like this. We just know that, which is rather recent, and which is maybe the start of some further developments. So maybe I should stop now. Thank you.
Is that also a theorem that follows from automata theory?
Which one?
Rho not in Q and the earlier.
No.
Right there, I guess.
This result of Ecke-Mahler uses some method of Mahler involving functional equations, so it's completely different. Yes. The connection? At the beginning, I had three numbers, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. We know that we need at least three numbers to have something which is dense. And the four exponential conjecture says that if the four exponential conjecture is true, then the subgroup generated, multiplicative group generated by the images of these numbers is dense. Now, the sixth exponential theorem is sufficient to prove when we take one more with alpha 4, and the next step is that if we take five elements, alpha 1, alpha 2, up to alpha 5, then there is a subgroup of rank 3. So there are three elements in the subgroup which generate something which is dense. And we do not know how to find them. We just know that they exist. Oh, there is a question over there. Yes, please.
She's asking for the definition of automaton.
The definition of automaton. Ah, yes, this is something which would take time to define very properly. A finite automaton is something like this. You have some states, and so you have several states, and you enter the decimal expansion of the binary expansion of a number. And then, so you start from here, you look at your number, and you look at its decimal expansion. So you, for example, you will enter the integers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. So for each integer, you take the integer n, you enter it, but you write n in binary expansion. And then you read your number n. So let me say that n has a binary expansion which is 1, 0, 1, 1, 0. This is my binary expansion. And you have several states. So when you enter your number, you first look at this, and you say what you do when you get 0. So from this state, say that 0, you stay in this state. And then when you have 1, you go to the next state. And then you say what you have to do when you have 0 and 1. So for example, you can put here 0, and I will take just these states here, and then 1. So you see, you start from 0, you stay in this state. Then you have 1, you go here. Then you have 1, you come back here. You have 0, you stay. You have 1, and you come here. And you look at the output. And let me say that the output will be 1, here, and 0 here. And so, starting from n, you deduce either 0 or 1. And so now, when do you get 0 and when do you get 1? It's not difficult to see. If n has an even number of 1, the output is 1. If it has an odd number of 1, the output is 0. So like this, you get another sequence. And this other sequence will not be the decimal expansion, the binary expansion of an algebraic number. An algebraic number cannot be obtained by such a finite automaton. So I thank you for staying up to now, and also for the invitation and the idea of asking me to give these lectures. And we will you will see this lecture on YouTube, hopefully.